Yeah. We are actually used to, when we are communicating with each other by phone or video, we hear each other. We hear each other immediately. That's even considered normal. Like immediately what you say, you receive it, you hear it, or you see it waving, you see it actually. That is something we completely consider for granted. It's normal. But tact is something more static. You can look at newspapers, for example, websites, PowerPoint slides. I don't see anything moving at this moment. It's static. And we also consider it normal. That's the way how we have and use tact. Okay. But we're also using tact more and more to communicate a lot more interactive, more directly. And that is quite a lot. We are using quite often text messaging or SMS on mobile phones, and it's quite popular, especially with younger people, and also deaf and hard of hearing people use it as well. It allows us to communicate. And instant messaging is getting popular as well. I mean, it's over 10 years old already. I'm using it quite a lot. It helps, it works. But I have noticed when you really need to communicate more efficiently, when you really need to grab a hold of a person, you pick up the phone. When you call, hello, I cannot get you an instant messaging, I really need to get a hold of, when's your appointment, where are you going, or the house on fire, anything. So, SMS and instant messaging is never be used for all people to directly get grab a hold, directly contact. It's more, I send a message, I might get it 5 minutes later, might be 30 minutes later, might be next day, it might be never. It happens. So, if you depend on tact to communicate, for example, if you cannot hear or speak, like me, I can speak, although I hope you can notice that, but you are in a situation where voice is inappropriate. For example, when you're sitting here and the phone is going, you need to call back the person, you have to walk outside, then use voice to call. Or when there's a lot of background noise, or in a restaurant, cinema, theater, or conference like this. So, now something new. Take the mute time as well. Hallelujah, it's possible. Now, what is real-time text? Real-time text, as you can see in the example, is text that is sent and received on a character-by-character basis. If you type faster, it can be multiple characters. The character is sent immediately when I'm typing. The character is received almost immediately when it's typed by a distant person. And it's actually talking using text. You can see. It's a conversation between two people. They're actually talking. And you can see the speed of the person typing. You see all the errors that happens. No typing error, that always happens, that's normal. But it's direct. You can see the person typing. You know somebody's on the other side of the line. Well, let's compare it when you're using instant messaging. Where you see pop-up messages. It's very popular, okay, yeah. It is a great way to communicate each other when it's not urgent. But if I'm doing instant messaging right now, I send a message, I continue reading my email, playing a computer game, something else, even changing laundry, whatever. Because I know I'm not getting a response immediately. Instant messaging is not the way if you really want to talk with the other person. If instant messaging was really that great, why do so many people switch back to phone and talk each other? And instant messaging is a great tool to communicate each other. I'm saying it's great, I'm not saying it's bad, but please use it in the right way, in the right moment. We are not communicating directly, don't want to talk directly. Because, you see, it takes time. You have to wait before you get an answer. You have no idea if somebody's typing. Some programs allow indication person is typing. You still have to wait. What are you going to say? And this is only one way. Suppose you have to read, and then you have to answer. You have even more delay. That is not a way to have a conversation. I mean, would you accept it if your telephone was like this? I'm calling you, I'm speaking your voicemail. Hey, hi, Arnoud. Is the appointment still going on for today? Because you still need to print out of the meeting. You listen to voicemail, you speak into my voicemail. Let's assume that I can use voicemail, but now I listen. Okay, now I speak into your voicemail again. That's exactly the same thing. You wouldn't accept it, would you? So, and the nice thing about real-time text is it is an ITU T140 real-time text presentation layer protocol. It's an ITU standard. How to display the text, how to delete text if you're typing, how it can be presented. It is also based on the ISO 10.6461 character set and uses UTF-8 format. That means that every character you can put on the PowerPoint slide, it can be Chinese, it can be Greek, it can be native Indian language, or Swedish, that doesn't matter. If you can type it on your computer, you can send it in real time to the other person. That's quite important. It also uses the same real-time transport as voice IP and video IP. And I've described its encoder according to the IGF standard 4103, and it's also called TechWave IP. It's not a stranger. If you have a network that supports voice IP, you can actually use real-time text as well. You don't need expensive investment. It's so easy to implement it. But you have to know that it exists. And RFC5194 describes actually how to implement it, what to expect in networks. But if you're interested, you can have a look at it. Or you can email me with questions. Now, the important point is to make people aware about real-time text, because we all think too much text is static. So the real-time text task force has its goal, and I'll let you say the website is www.realtimetech.org. I hope it's easy to remember. And the goal of real-time text task force is to make real-time text just as available as voices, such as normal, common, or available as voices. Just make sure that you have one phone and another phone, and you can still communicate with each other. Because if I buy a Nokia and I have a Siemens, you know you can contact each other. You can contact with the landline phone. You're not surprised about it. That is normal. You will read them exactly the same thing. Just use it, without complications. And that's also important to have a roadmap on the future evolution, and also about interoperability. Because everybody needs just pick up the phone and type for real-time text. So interoperability is quite important. Information about real-time text, how to implement it, is also available on the site, and we can help with that. And it's also an open forum for engineers. Motivated individuals, everybody is welcome. You can all join the task force. Come with your background, come with your questions, come with implementations, come with testing, you're welcome. Because we all want real-time tech such a failure for everyone. So, all people can use real-time tech to talk with tech, whenever, wherever. And the support of internet telephony, nothing is changed, technology is available. You can use simultaneously with voice and video. That's called total conversation. Imagine, I'm here, I can see video with you, you can hear my audio, and in my case, I prefer to have real-time text back. And you have a nice conversation, you can see each other, that's a nice way. And if you have a different kind of disability, if you need sign language, you can sign, and if you have names, addresses, you can type it. Or if you're talking with each other, you can have real-time text using translation. For example, if you're Polish, talk with an English person, you can have a Polish, English, English, Polish translation in text. That's really nice. So, and it, you can support with IP telephony, but you can also use it as standalone, just text only. People with deaf and hard hearing can communicate without restrictions. It doesn't matter if you're deaf or hard hearing. You can just use text. If with your fingers, you can type it, you can read it. The real-time tech task force will make it possible with your help. And if you have questions, I think it's mostly on Saturday. Yeah. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Arnaud.
You're welcome.
And yes, all the questions, as we said, we're probably going to take the Dynamic Coalition meeting, because we are going to be late. Please join the Dynamic Coalition meeting on Saturday in the morning. But now we go on with the next speaker, which is my colleague from ITU. Actually, I didn't introduce myself. I'm Stefano Polidori. I'm working in the standardization sector of the ITU, so the ITUT. And I'm supporting various activities related to accessibility, like the joint coordination activity on accessibility and human factor, and this Dynamic Coalition on accessibility and disability. But coming back to my colleague, Peter Major, he's working in another sector of ITU, which is the radio communication sector, dealing with radio spectrum, satellites, etc. And you will know a little bit more on how they are addressing accessibility with his presentation, which is Space Network System Online and Accessibility. Thank you, Peter.
Thank you, Stefano. Good morning, everyone. I'm happy to be here with you and share some of the experiences we had with the accessibility. Basically, I'm going to talk about a system which is a web-based application which is called Space Network Systems Online. And to go through what we are going to deal with, it's quite a lot. First of all, I want to touch upon the ITU commitment to accessibility, though it has been already mentioned during the introductory speech of Mr. Malcolm Johnson. I would give you very shortly some background information concerning the telecommunications, satellites, orbits, regulations, and so on. Basically, I will also talk a bit about the Space Network System database itself, and I get to the main point, that is the Space Network Systems Online, which is the web-based application. It has been thought to be a kind of pilot project since the system has been designed in the very early times, that is in 1994, when we didn't really have much notion about accessibility issues, and we didn't have, in fact, any knowledge about that. So I'm going to deal with the goals, methods, processes, and results, and finally the lessons we learned about accessibility and from this exercise. So I just put up the slide about ITU commitment about accessibility, which has been reiterated by our Secretary General Dr. Hamadoun Touré in Cairo this year. Basically, he has reiterated all the activities we have been doing. That is, we have providing recommendations, we are organizing workshops, reports, and questions related to accessibility, related to people with disabilities. We have created this dynamic coalition, Accessibility and Disability, and it occurred to me that probably it would be a good idea to put it into practice, to have the ITU website, and in particular, the web applications accessible to visually impaired people. By the way, I have to pay tribute to Andreas Sachs and Cynthia Waddell, who co-chaired the ITU tutorial in April this year, which really triggered me to do this exercise. I mean, it was such a wonderful opportunity to me to attend this tutorial that on the spur of the moment I decided that, okay, let's do something for real. And I selected my own application, which I told you about, that is SNS Online, which has quite a large, a very specialized user community, and which is in fact the biggest web-based application, ITU BR, that is the Radio Communication Bureau. Some words about satellite communication. Probably it's needless to go into details. Well, we are dealing with satellites in telecommunication services, geostation satellites, which orbit around the Earth with the same velocity as the Earth rotation, and non-geo satellites, which have different velocity. And of course, we have the Earth stations. Just to illustrate, here is a slide to show that probably you will have the presentation downloadable from our website. Well, the basic thing we are dealing with in the Radio Communication Bureau is the interference-free operation. So that is the basic message. Now, as for the database we are dealing with, we are trying to get to have as many characteristics of all these satellite radio communication systems as possible. That is the name, the position, the frequency, emissions. It's a huge database. Now, on top of this database, I have started designing a system in 94 to give a direct access. Mind you, 94 was quite a long time ago, so we have just been about to start using the web browsers. And the system was put into operation in 95. So it evolved during the times with more than 100 static pages, and we have more than 240 dynamic pages accessing the database. And of course, we have a lot of links, and we have other useful information. So, as I told you, there were no considerations at the time of designing for accessibility issues, and there was a lack of knowledge. And since we are dealing with a large user community, probably it won't be directly, it won't have a direct impact on this community, but I think the indirect impact may be quite significant. So let's go and retrofit. Well, that's an exercise. That's a real exercise to do it. Well, what are the goals? Let's make all the web pages available and accessible for visually impaired. Let's use technologies which are really very easily can be accessed and are available almost free of charge. That is, one of them is Cynthia Says, named after Cynthia Waddell, a wave. And you have demo version of Joe's, which is a screen reader. So we decided to go ahead, not to do any fuss about it, and let's identify the problems. And other goal was to gain experience, to have a formalized approach, and make it available within ITU. So, and if everything goes all right, well, why not inject the findings to study groups, eventually to have some recommendation from ITU. So that's what we did. Well, what were the methods? We created an inventory of the older web pages of SNS Online, all the HTMLs, the forms, the help, the demo pages, and naturally about the add-ons and the download, the graphic components. We deployed all the tools I've just mentioned. And last but not least, what I think is one of the most important part, I thought that, well, why not identify real needs? So I got into contact with the Association for Blind and Visually Impaired Persons in Geneva, Switzerland. And in fact, with a colleague of mine, we went and visited them and asked for their advice. So, what was the process we did? We identified the accessibility errors on static pages. We modified the static pages. Then, of course, all these tools I've been talking about, or most of them, can access only pages on the public space. So we had to transfer it to the external web server, modify the pages, I mean, identify again the remaining errors, retransferring them, modifying them, and repeat the process until we had no errors. Of course, there is a specific problem with JavaScript. We had to modify the JavaScript as well. They were quite complex. Well, I don't really want to go any more into detail. We checked all the dynamic pages, and we managed in the end to come up with all the static pages, including the JavaScript, error-free. And I can tell you, neither Wave nor Synthesis found or detected any errors. We have tested most of the dynamic pages, but the process is still ongoing. As a conclusion, I have to tell you, retrofitting is a very, very complex process. Don't do it if you can avoid it. But if you have to do it naturally, you do it. But in new systems, take into consideration of the accessibility rules, of the accessibility standards, recommendations, and requirements, and try and design at the very outset considering these aspects. To me, it was a very, very interesting experience to get the requirements from real users and get the feedback from the real users, because we have gone through that as well. So what is next? We would like to complete the tests of the dynamic pages. We would like to check the add-ons, that is the download, the external links. And there is one very interesting thing, since SNS Online presents you with a lot of diagrams, graphical information, that is, you have the radiation diagrams, you have the service area diagrams, and so on and so forth. So at least to provide the users some descriptive details. We should have further tests, and of course, that is one of the opportunity. I make the experiences available within the dynamic coalition, but I would like to spread the experiences in ITU. Now, I think I don't really have time, Stefano, to show the online demonstration, but believe me, we have tried it. There is a demo, a two-minute demo with Joe's, and the thing is working perfectly all right. It has been tested. So I'm ready to take your questions probably during Saturday, and you can find the whole presentation on the website. Thank you.
Switch Tom, Peter. All right.
Tab, table, column 2, row 1, satellite Earth station name, edit, type in text, EUELAT, space, 2-6, forms mode off, enter. Heading level 2, space network systems online, heading level 3, general query system, list of geostationary satellite stations, link graphic help. Export results to link graphic SNS access, link graphic SNS Excel, link graphic help table worksheet geo list. Table with 8 columns and 8 rows. Link satellite name, link category, link ADM, link NTWK org, link longitude, link date of protection, link status, link IFIC. Link Itelsa 216, EUFUD 16, link Seatsum, link 50, link 2422, link Itelsa 216, ECFUD 16, link Seatsum, link 50, link 2088, link Itelsa 216, ENFUD 16, link Seatsum, link 50, link 2468.
Okay, Peter, thank you very much for this presentation and for the video at the end. I'm going to introduce the next speaker, which is Dipendra Manocha from DICE Consortium. Dipendra is going to give a presentation on information accessibility for disaster preparedness. So, Dipendra, I'm going to load your presentation. And I'll tell you when I'm ready. Okay, your presentation is on the screen. You can go ahead, thanks.
Okay. Thank you, Stefano, and good morning, everybody. I'm going to talk about the DAISY standards and also one of its use cases, because DAISY standards deal with accessibility of the information. And accessibility of information has got many implications. So disaster management has been picked up as one of the use cases for this implications of what role an accessible information can play. Before we get on to disaster preparedness or disaster management, just a line about DAISY consortium, a reminder, or the DAISY standards, should I say, are the standards laid down, which are open royalty-free standards laid down, which describe how content needs to be produced or presented. The way content needs to be published so that everybody, including any person with disability, are able to access them in the format that is suitable for them. So considering this huge goal in mind, DAISY Consortium lays down standards for basically documents and publications. And it's all talking about digital content. So internet, we know, is one of the major carriers of the digital content to everybody. And therefore, the DAISY content actually also uses internet for taking the content to the end users, as the case may be. So that is not the only way how it deals, but we will cover that in our presentation later when we discuss this use case. So we go on to the first slide. Now here what is there on the screen is a very horrifying picture of the tsunami which struck in Indian Ocean and South and Southeast Asia. What we see here is that a huge wave is now almost upon the persons who are standing there on the beach, and they are now starting to run for their lives. Now this particular picture, whosoever might have taken it, was able to save his life just by chance. And there is a very something which needs to be noticed why I've used this picture is that if the persons who are there on this picture knew beforehand that such a calamity or the water is going to rise to this level, would not have been there where they are right now. It's significant that they were not really prepared for this calamity. They just did not know anything about this. And why I've chosen this picture is again because in the vicinity of the same beach for which we see the picture here, lived an indigenous community, out of which maybe 50% of the persons were not educated at all, and they were there. It's a fishermen's community living on that side of the same beach. We are talking about the Phuket beach here, and not even one single person of that community actually suffered from this calamity. Not even one single life was lost, just because they knew the symptoms of the sea, and they saw the symptoms of the sea, and they ran for a higher ground. And so they were at the higher ground when this wave was actually striking the beach. I go to the next slide. This is another example now. What we see here is something which has happened this year in India, in the state of Bihar. What we see here is an aerial view of a state of which more than 50% of the land of the state was submerged in water. It was not a normal flood of a river that happened here. It was a breach of an embankment of the river, and the river itself changed its course. And not by a small thing. I mean, the river used to flow from one place, but now it flows 259 kilometers away from where it actually flowed. It's a huge distance, huge diversion for a river to take place. So as a result, today also, a lot of people who had their houses, now those houses are inside the river because they had never seen the flood. They were 250 kilometers away from the river, so they had never seen a flood before. And now suddenly their whole fields, their houses, everything is part of the river. What can be done in such situations, and how can these disasters be managed, is something that we are going to talk about now. Next slide, we will see. Disaster management primarily is of have these three components. One is that we have to be prepared for a disaster. We have to be prepared so as to know what to do when a disaster actually takes place. Because when disaster takes place, there is no time to think. There is no time to decide what is good, what is bad, and what will work and what will not work. Only thing which will work is the prior knowledge. Something which even in your extreme nervousness, anxiety, you don't forget. Something that is built into you, ingrained into you, drilled into your mind, is something that is going to stay with you during that tough time. So disaster preparedness is all about knowing what to do when any adverse condition takes place. Disaster warning is another very important aspect of disaster management. Means that we saw those tsunami pictures. There was a chance of providing warning about a wave of that height hitting the shores maybe 1 hour before it actually did. Because tsunami always happens after an earthquake, and there was a difference, for example, on all the Indian coasts, there was a difference of 1.5 hours between when actually the earthquake came and when the tsunami came. And yet, nobody knew that a tsunami could happen. So there was no warning system in place, and obviously the warning could not reach the people who got affected later on. The third aspect, of course, is disaster rescue operations. Now, once something has happened, if there are some people who are trapped, we need to rescue them. So in all these circumstances, we know that the information plays an extremely important role. All we are talking about here is information, actually. To be prepared, we need to know what needs to be done. We need this information drilled into us. We need this information drilled into the mind of everybody, what needs to be done at an adverse time. We need warning systems. We need information to be given to people at right time that they can access themselves. And the rescue operations is again a lot dependent on information. Where are the people who need to be rescued? The information needs to be reached, information needs to be provided to the rescue people who are rescuing people. So information actually plays an extremely central role in all these three aspects of disaster management. Now, who needs this information? We are talking that we need to provide information. Now, to whom is what we are seeing here? It is not to be provided just to the people who have all their senses working in so-called normal range. It is surprising to know that 40 to 50%, at least the population of 40 to 50%, we are talking about 10% who are legally persons with disabilities, but there are actually 40 to 50% of the persons who have limitations in accessing information. Or maybe in many of the developing countries, this percentage could be higher than that. Because they are, what are the kind of people who we are talking about? But people who cannot read and write. Maybe they are illiterate. There is a huge range of people who cannot read and write. That means a normal print text is nothing for them. It doesn't carry any meaning. Whether it is SMS, it's a website, or it's a paper, pamphlet, nothing is accessible to them. People who cannot hear or who have limited hearing. So, people who have vision impairment, people who might have multiple disabilities, people with cognitive impairments. Maybe if we type normal text, maybe somebody might have no problem in reading that text, but understanding might be a challenge. Now, if you have to provide information to all of these or any other categories which perceive information only in a specified format, then what is it that our information should be? We need to go to the next slide, which talks about features of accessible information. Now, the very basic feature of accessible information is that it cannot be delivered in only one media. We can't say that we deliver something in normal printed text and that would be accessible to all, no matter what we write on that, no matter how we write on that, no matter what point size we use. It might cover a lot of people if we make it large print, if you make it normal print in your local language. It might cover a lot of people, but it would never be able to cover all, because we are leaving out illiterate, we are leaving out people who cannot see. If we provide information which is in audio only, then of course we are leaving out people with hearing impairment. So one key feature of accessible information is that this is the information which cannot be delivered only in one media. It has to be the same information in its complete meaning should be delivered in more than one media. We are not talking of medias complementing each other. We are talking here of media which contains complete information in its entirety with its complete meaning to reach a person in more than one media. This information should be easy to create. We all know it. Anything which is complicated, most of the people don't access it. Most of the people don't use it. It has to be very easy to use to create and to read. This media has to be delivered through multiple devices, because again, we don't live in a singular monocolored society. Everybody is going to use different kinds of devices, different kinds of mediums to access this information. Somebody would get it on their mobile phone, somebody would prefer a normal printed paper, somebody would say, okay, I might just use a cassette player or a CD player or a braille book or anything that we talk about. It could be so many different mediums that would be used for accessing this information. Now, last, which is a very important aspect of this, is that this information should actually be convertible also. Because we are delivering it in maybe two or three formats, but there are so many more formats that end user might require. A very glaring example of that is Braille, for example, for persons with blindness. Or persons who are deafblind, for example, if you talk about Braille, there is no other alternative. That person needs to have that information in Braille, and that is how that person will access it. He might access it using his Braille display. Now, this particular information, if the text of it needs to be convertible to Braille, we cannot send an image. Image cannot be converted into Braille. So, if there is an image, there has to be a text that goes along with that image which would get converted into Braille. If and other aspects of convertibility would be, are we using standard coding systems? Are we do we have tools that are going to convert these things, the information into various formats? This is what needs to be done. The convertibility from one format and one media to another media or another format is another very essential feature of information that we might have. Now, why we say this is, let us see an example here in the next slide. If you could just play. Yeah.
Load. Done.
Be careful of tsunamis. Quick evacuation.
The tsunami will hit immediately after the earthquake. Zaboom.
After the earth shakes, let's evacuate to a safe place.
If you are in the area of a potential tsunami disaster, you must evacuate immediately.
Okay, I think I'll just...
Don't wait for the warning.
Maybe we can stop here.
Right. Please be well prepared for the emergency.
Okay. Now, you can see that this is a DAISY book, which, and let's see what feature it covers. It has text, it has audio, it has pictures. It's in very simple language. It is the disaster. It is a book. It is a publication that is dealing with disaster preparedness, drilling information about what needs to be done to be safe from tsunami. Now, this doesn't end here, because it is giving you information in three. It's a synchronized presentation of three different mediums here: graphics, text, and audio.
Be well prepared for the emergency.
It is also convertible. Because it is open source, the text is, we can easily derive text out of it, and the tools are available to convert them into Braille, represent them into Braille. It is playable on so many different mediums. Right now we saw it on a computer, but the same thing without any convertibility. If I simply write it on a CD and put it on a CD player, it will actually give me the whole thing in audio format. If I put it on a mobile phone, I can access the same content. The flash drive, mobile phones, I could print it on a paper, I could print it in Braille. It covers a huge variety of mediums on which this can be displayed. Why this is happening? Because this is a very, very standardized format now. Player manufacturers know how to make information accessible. They simply need to add feature to support for DAISY. For example, a Firefox web browser might are adding support for DAISY. That means if the content is available in DAISY format, it could be played right through your browser. Microsoft Word provides adds support to this thing called Save as DAISY. Means if you have a document in MS Word, you can create a DAISY publication out of MS Word. So the creation is becoming easier, the accessing of the information is becoming easier. What needs to be done by all of us is to be aware that yes, this standard exists and we need to follow these standards. These are going to take care of the needs of not just persons with blindness, but persons who cannot read due to any reason. There is video which is coming in the revisions of the DAISY standards, which means primarily to address the needs of the persons with hearing impairment. Captioning is possible. For persons with cognitive impairment, more than one medias get involved into it. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Dipendra, for this very clear presentation on disaster preparedness for people with disabilities. So first I'd like to apologize on the next session panel for this little delay, 5 minutes after we took from your time. We're really sorry for that, but we had to start late. So I think we have to close now to give a possibility to the next session to go ahead. I would like to ask you if you made use of this form for the question, to give it the form to me, and then please join everybody on Saturday at 9:30 in room 5, which is next to this room, and we will have a very interesting meeting on the Dynamic Coalition on Accessibility and Disability. And the purpose of this meeting, the main purpose, is to approve a declaration which is very important. So I would really ask you everybody to join the meeting, and we will have also time to follow up on this workshop and to answer any question with a more debate. Thank you very much, and see you on Saturday.
I'm actually not here on Saturday. Is it possible to just email in my credits?
Yes, the only thing I have to remove the computer from